Hi, Ed. So why is this new book important? What's the essence of what you're trying to get across here?
Well, the essence of what I'm trying to get across is we're on the verge of what I call a technology tsunami, the convergence of many different technologies that are going to transform how we do business, how we work, the future of work, and quite frankly, how we live. And how people adapt and adjust to that is going to be really dependent upon how they think, how they listen, how they relate, and how they collaborate. So the new book really puts forth a model for the journey to one's best self in the smart machine age. And it's based on science and various sciences, psychology, neuroscience, but also it's very practical. It's a how-to book. How do you think better? How do you manage your emotions? How do you overcome and lessen your ego? What type of culture will enable the highest performance emotionally and cognitively? What type of leadership model? So it puts forth, if you will, the science and brings psychology into the business world. Psychology is going to be as important to business as strategy and finance is.
And so why have leaders got to change? You know, with that, are they all stuck in a rut? Are they living in the 20th
well,
century?
Because
they're all comfortable and happy and comfortable, aren't they, really?
They're happy and comfortable because the system is the Industrial Revolutionary Model system. Yeah. Efficiency, productivity, command and control, direct. We need a mass number of people to do the same repetitive jobs over and over again, 99% defect-free on time. Well, going forward in the smart machine age, the technology is going to basically take over most of the operational excellence type of task, all right? Operational excellence is going to become table stakes to stay in business. The value creation differentiator is going to be innovation. Innovation is very different, all right? It takes a different way of thinking, different processes, different, if you will, risk profile. And the fact of the matter is you cannot command and control human beings to think innovatively or creatively. You cannot command and control human beings to have emotional intelligence. And those are the skills, the collaboration skills and thinking skills that where humans are going to add value. Humans are going to be needed to do what the technology can't do well. That means, in my view, that command and control, direct, my way or the highway, corporate hierarchy, and you know, go along, get along, is all history. Leaders are going to become enablers of the highest level of human performance to create an environment that enables high emotional and cognitive performance by the human component of the business. This is new. This is different. It's different being an enabler because then, if you will, the all-knowing leader will go basically be gone because nobody's going to know where all this is going to go. The velocity of change is going to be so fast.
So how am I going to get people to change? I mean, on our program, we find it hard to get people to look at doing something differently, you know, unless there's a real motivator there. How are you going as these organizations getting to actually do this stuff?
They've got to make meaning of the why. Why should they change? And it takes conversations, and in my working in organizations, it takes people basically about a day of work to get to a point of coming up with their personal story. Why should we change? Why should I change? And the motivator behind the change is different for different people, all right? Some people get excited about the fact that of competition, that they want to be one of the firms that succeeds. Some people get motivated by stewardship and giving back to the company. The company's given so much to them and have made them so wealthy, they want to leave the company in good shape for the future. So it's stewardship. Some of it is values of that, wow, this is the right thing to do for our people. This is the right thing to do for society. So people have to, it's what I call a process of making meaning, okay? Why should I change? Then once you define the why, what's the how? What does it mean? What's the objective? It's the why and the what. What's the objective? What's the strategic objective? Is it to be faster, better learning? More innovation, more high engagement. It's got to be tied to a strategic objective, and then you move to the behaviors. What are the behaviors we want more of, and what are the behaviors we want less of? Then you move to what processes. The research shows that companies that make these transitions are very process-oriented. They use processes every day in every meeting to help people learn the new ways to think, listen, relate, and collaborate together.
And so we talked about the behavioural thing, measuring it. So
yes.
So again, if it doesn't get measured, how are you getting what systems are they putting in place and you know, talk about that part of it.
Every person in let's just call the organization of the future a human developmental organization. Every person in the organization ultimately is going to have a development program. What do I need to work on? Some people need to work on quieting ego. Other people need to work on listening. Other people need to work on how to connect and relate emotionally with people. Other people need to learn how to critically think. Other people need to learn how to do rapid experiments for innovation. Everybody will have their development program, but underlying innovation, operational excellence are certain fundamental behaviors, if you will, about thinking, listening, connecting, and managing self, managing your ego, managing your fears. So everybody will have something they're working on, and they will, and it'll be an idea meritocracy, full open book, candor, transparency. People will know what people are working on. So after every meeting, it takes 2 to 3 minutes, everybody basically will grade how they did, and let's just say I'm working on listening, not interrupting people. I'll write down, all right, this meeting, how many times did I interrupt somebody? What caused me to interrupt? What was the trigger? Can I write anything? Then I'll get feedback from people, and I'll measure myself every day. It won't, and eventually it'll go into an app that's private and personal that everybody be using, and you'll ask people, hey, I'm working on interrupting people. When you see me doing something, interrupting, raise your hand, call me out right there on time where I can think about what triggered the interruption. It's that type of human work and people helping each other be better, because everybody's going to have a long list.
So everyone's bought into this. So again, this is a top-down thing that you're doing. So when you're starting to try and work on your behaviors, everyone knows why you're doing it, and everyone's involved.
And the leader has to be transparent, vulnerable, and role model. The system doesn't work unless the leaders lead the transformation and basically become very humanistic leaders, open and candid and vulnerable about what they're working on, and empowering people that report to them to hold them accountable for their improvement.
Yeah. And what about the recruitment? You said because you've documented some of these behaviors, you're then recruiting for those kind of behaviors.
Yes.
Is that?
Yes, you're recruiting for behaviors, and so you're testing for certain inclinations, all right, in behaviors. And you're grading people on behaviors when you're doing the interviews. And so you're trying to recruit for mindset, and you're trying to recruit for behaviors. And the mindset basically is we'll call it either Carol Dweck's growth mindset, or what I call in the book the new smart mindset. And the new smart mindset is, if you will, to think more like a scientist. I'm not my ideas, I'm open-minded, I'm data-driven, I basically go where the facts go, and I'm willing to stress test and seek to stress test my beliefs, and my beliefs are only hypothesis. And the big things that catch with people are, I'm not my ideas, listen to learn, not to confirm, collaboration is not competition. Yes and, not yes but.
And so in terms of people that, are some people left behind? Or most of the organizations you've worked with, are they trying to change the people they've already got? I mean, how are they, the people that don't get it, or normally are they coached and because everyone's doing it, they transition?
Everybody that I'm working with is, if you will, inviting every employee to be part of this transformation. Organizations don't transform unless people transform. Yeah. People don't transform unless their leaders and managers transform. So they're inviting everybody. Everybody's realistic. Some people will not be comfortable in the new environment. It's very open, candid, transparent, people holding each other accountable for behaviors. Hard for people to change. It takes patience, it takes compassion. The organization will become much more humanistic, much more people-centric. The amazing thing about the era we're going into, Bob, is that technology is going to dehumanize the workplace, and the fact it's going to reduce human headcount. In some industries, materially. But the fascinating thing, it's going to make the environment in the business much more humanistic than it is in most places today. And psychological principles are going to drive and affect that environment. It's going to be an idea of meritocracy that's psychologically safe. And so people are giving people, if you will, the time to work on it. Certain people that don't like it will opt out of it. Yes, even in these companies, there are going to be people that ultimately, because of the speed of change and the rapidity of change, they can't adapt fast enough and they're not comfortable, and they'll seek an organization or another type of position where they're more comfortable as a person.
Okay, great, that's brilliant, I think. Thank you very much.
Good.